For many millions of years after the first animals began to crawl onto land in the early Paleozoic, the Earth still lacked the big, charismatic animals of later eras. Unlike the mammals of the Cenozoic or the dinosaurs of the Mesozoic, land animals for most of the Paleozoic were either very small or were burdened by a need to return to water frequently. On a Paleozoic safari, there wouldn't be the familiar sights of big herds of grazing herbivores or large predators stalking them. But towards the end of the Paleozoic, things started to change, and by the beginning of the Permian period, vertebrates had become better adapted for land, pioneering the ecological niches that define terrestrial life today. Together, these pioneers formed the first large land animal fauna, and although they took many evolutionary pathways, many of them converged on one very specific adaptation, largely unseen in the modern world. Fifteen million years into the Permian, and the climate is still getting warmer and drier as the swamp forests of the Carboniferous continue to give way to dry land. Just like in the Carboniferous, drier areas like these are mostly populated by seed-bearing plants, but these forests of primitive Walchian conifers harbor animals that share their ability to live beyond the wetlands. Insects and other arthropods have inhabited drier areas of the continents for many millions of years now, since their aquatic ancestors already had an exoskeleton that was pre-adapted to prevent water loss. Meanwhile, our primitive tetrapod ancestors had moist skin and eggs that needed to be laid in water, preventing them from fully colonizing the land. But back in the Carboniferous period, one group of tetrapods, the amniotes, broke free of this restriction. They evolved both dry skin and eggs that could be laid on land, allowing them to become fully terrestrial. Both of the two main amniote groups, Sauropsida and Synapsida, started out as small insect eaters, and many of them still fill this niche in the early Permian. Despite their lizard-like appearances, none of these creatures are reptiles as we know them. All modern reptiles, from turtles to snakes to crocodiles and birds, belong to a group of diapsid sauropsids called Sauria, and there's no evidence for any saurians at this point in the early Permian. And although diapsida had been around since the Carboniferous, early Permian diapsids like the Aria solidians were still outnumbered by more primitive varieties of sauropsids scurrying through the undergrowth. One major group was Captorhinidae. While they may not look like much, the mouths of some species harbored multiple rows of teeth like a shark's, and even though they were only distant cousins to the reptiles we have today, recent discoveries have shown that at least some of them could detach their tails mid-vertebra in much the same way that lizards do. While the Captorhinids and diapsids belong to the eureptile branch of Sauropsida, there was another long-lost branch of sauropsids that has left no descendants in the modern world, the parareptiles. Lots of parareptiles were also small carnivores, and while many were primitive-looking like the Lanthanosuchoids, a bolosaurid called Eudibomus cursorus is the first two-legged vertebrate known in the fossil record, 50 million years before the first dinosaur. Meanwhile, there were small insectivores on the synapsid side of the tree as well, including the Eothyrids. Like all synapsids, these fanged hunters were more closely related to mammals than to any reptile. But while the Eothyrids and other small amniotes preyed on insects, there were larger predators on the prowl for larger prey. Among the sauropsids, some Captorhinids and parareptiles were large enough to prey on other tetrapods. But unlike in later periods that would be dominated by enormous skyscraper-sized reptiles, in the early Permian, a 6-foot Captorhinid is just about the largest sauropsid you'll get. Among the synapsids, the Varanopids were some of the most prolific medium-sized predators. Thanks to some extraordinary paleontological finds, we have an unusually good deal of information about their anatomy and behavior. Fossils from earlier in the Permian show that they had scales shaped like those of a lizard or snake. And a fossilized burrow from much later in the Permian contains what may be the earliest known evidence for parental care in the fossil record, an adult Varanopid huddled with younger individuals of different ages. This parental care could have evolved separately from the care we see in modern mammals, but it could also mean that parental care originated near the beginning of the synapsid family tree, and that nearly all synapsids inherited it. Even though synapsid eggs are amniotic, they are not quite as waterproof as the eggs of most modern reptiles and birds, and they needed to be kept from drying out. Perhaps parental care was a solution to this problem. And while in modern mammals, milk is used to nourish the young, it may have originated as a secretion meant to keep early synapsid eggs moist. In modern times, terrestrial predators mostly subsist on other land animals, but early Permian predators often fed on aquatic animals as well. In the swamps, sharks, other fish, and primitive amphibious tetrapods were still in abundance. Not all of these primitive tetrapods were as water-dependent as the typical amphibian. Several groups of non-amniote tetrapods had independently evolved to become more terrestrial, although they presumably still had to lay their eggs in water. Some members of Cimoria morpha possessed dry skin and muscular legs, which helped when hunting small animals on land as adults. Although they were long considered to be relatives of the amniotes, their position within the tetrapods is now uncertain. Meanwhile, another group of tetrapods, the Dicerophoids, had evolved towards life on land as well. They were members of the ancient group Temnospondyli, and were close relatives of modern amphibians. In addition to their terrestrial adaptations, a lot of them had armor on their backs as protection against predators. One Dicerophoid, Platyhistrix rugosus, sported a little sail on its back, but it was far from the only Permian creature with such ornamentation. While many of the terrestrial food chains in the early Permian were based on aquatic food sources or insects, some tetrapods had begun to exploit a new food source, plants. The first major group of herbivorous tetrapods was Diadectidae. They were not amniotes, but were close relatives, and had remained the most prolific herbivores for the last 20 or so million years, with some growing up to 10 feet in length. Despite their primitive origins, fossil evidence suggests that they had upright limb posture and an ability to chew their food long before any amniotes evolved these features. Some amniotes took advantage of this food source as well. Unlike Eudibomus, some bolosaurid parareptiles evolved herbivorous diets, including Bolosaurus itself. But the most impressive herbivores of the time were synapsids. The Edaphosaurids were a group of mostly herbivores, all of which had large sails on their backs. The largest genus, Edaphosaurus, included some species that grew to 10 feet long. The Caseids were another group of synapsid herbivores. They were probably relatives of the Eothyrids, and both groups possessed a distinctive overbite. Caseids were a minor part of this fauna, but within the next 10 million years, they would diversify and produce 20-foot giants, becoming the largest land animals of their time. The biggest early Permian herbivores were probably too large for most predators to hunt, but there were some carnivorous synapsids that rose to the occasion. The Ophiacodontids started out small in the Carboniferous, but had quickly produced 10-foot carnivores like Ophiacodon itself by the time the Permian started, and 15 million years later, Ophiacodon and its relatives were still some of the largest predators on land. But there was another, more advanced group of carnivores. The Sphenacodontians were relatives of the Edaphosaurs, but they had a few distinguishing characteristics. The bone around the two largest teeth was thickened, and their front tooth sockets were deeper, both presumably reinforcing their teeth when biting. The front teeth were adapted for grabbing, and the back teeth were better for slicing. This type of dentition, in which there are two different types of tooth, is what lends its name to the most famous sphenacodontian genus, Dimetrodon. This animal also had a sail, but it had evolved separately from its Edaphosaurid relatives. Most sphenacodontians were small and lacked sails, but throughout the early Permian, the group produced many large species of Dimetrodon. And by this point in the Permian, Temnospondylus and Cicodontosaurus had recently joined their ranks. Why do we see so many instances of sails evolving in such a short time, when they are completely absent from the modern world? The most commonly suggested function for a large, thin sail is thermoregulation, allowing the animal to warm up blood by pumping it into the sail, where the sun could heat it easily. This was probably useful to these early land creatures, because unlike large animals from most other periods, they were probably completely cold-blooded. This fauna was unusual in other ways. For one, there was a lower herbivore-to-carnivore ratio than in most later warm-blooded faunas. Part of this was probably because a cold-blooded predator burns through food less quickly, so more of them could be sustained on a given amount of prey. Another reason may have been the way these food chains were structured, since many carnivores were feeding on aquatic creatures and insects instead of just the herbivorous vertebrates. This fauna had remained relatively unchanged for the last 20 million years, but the first wave of new Permian land vertebrates was beginning to take shape in the world of 284 million years ago, and Permian land ecosystems were about to start evolving at a much more rapid pace. While Dimetrodon and the other sailbacks would eventually be left behind, a few other sphenacodontians would continue to accumulate new adaptations that would allow them to keep up. These adaptations would define not only the next waves of synapsid radiation, but would also ensure the continued success of the last living sphenacodontians to this day, the mammals.